in the strongest terms for their handling of child abuse allegations over several decades. The independent inquiry into child sexual abuse took evidence from 38 groups, accusing some of morally failing children and of acting with blatant hypocrisy. We talked to one survivor about her experience with Jehovah's Witnesses and why it still affects her years later.
The sense of powerlessness and hopelessness, because I didn't fully recognise what was going on at the time was wrong.
The latest report follows similar inquiries into Anglican churches and the Roman Catholics. Also tonight, the subway flooded, roads and rail lines affected. Hurricane Ida hits New York, New Jersey and the northeast of America. Regular tests, better ventilation, just some of the measures adopted as England's pupils return to the classroom. And it's ABBA's first album of new material for 40 years, and it'll be backed up by a series of virtual concerts.
And coming up in the sport on the BBC News Channel, the late wicket of Joe Root leaves the fourth test between England and India finally poised after a dramatic first day at the Oval.
Good evening. Some of the major religious groups in England and Wales have been criticised in the strongest terms for the way in which they've handled allegations of child abuse over several decades. The independent inquiry into child sexual abuse accused them of morally failing children, of being responsible for shocking failings, and of acting with blatant hypocrisy. The inquiry examined evidence from 38 religious groups, having already looked into Anglican and Roman Catholic churches. Our Home Affairs correspondent, Tom Simons, has more details.
It's very difficult to form an identity and to be a whole person when you are on your own.
This is Sarah, born into the Jehovah's Witnesses, into a family dominated by the church.
Effectively, you were sexually abused by both your father and your mother.
Yeah.
Your father when you were much younger, and your mother when you were a little bit older, and they had control over you. What was that like?
I don't really have words to describe what that was like, honestly. The sense of powerlessness and hopelessness.
Sarah's not her real name. She was taken into care. She settled by the sea for a new start, away from the witnesses.
They teach that everyone who is not a witness is part of Satan's world, or Satan's system, as they call it. That makes you, as a young person, terrified to trust anyone outside of the organisation, and at the same time, terrified to trust anyone inside of the organisation. It was very difficult.
And it's a pattern repeated across religious groups investigated by this inquiry, which has also examined the Catholic and Anglican churches.
The way that leaders are revered, the culture of community and not taking things outside of the community, so dealing with everything internally, not making outside authorities aware so that it can be looked at in the wider sense, and making sure that the root causes of it are tackled, discouraging victims from reporting even within the organisation.
An example, the Jehovah's Witnesses have a policy that all child protection allegations have to be reported to the police. But inside the church, they also follow a biblical scripture, which says that all allegations must be supported by two witnesses. This report says that the two-witness rule should have no place in any response to child sexual abuse, which often happens with no witnesses. The church says it's committed to protecting children and will consider this report. In the ultra-Orthodox Jewish community, the inquiry heard about the concept of mesira, not snitching, as one witness put it, on a fellow Jew to outsiders. But campaigners are concerned that this report does not hit religious organisations hard enough.
They have to raise the bar for religious organisations and not give them leeway because they have religion on their side. Religion does not equal good enough safeguarding.
The report is short on a solution to all this, but that's what those who suffered as children, including Sarah, are now using their adult voices to demand.
Tom is with me now. You mentioned it's short on solutions. What are the likely answers and what are the likely kind of proposals that you think we can expect?
Well, look, we're 6 years into this inquiry. We've had hundreds of hours of evidence. We've had more than 12 reports. And it's a fair question because there haven't been many recommendations in these reports. But there is a big report next year, a final report, which has on the table a possible recommendation called mandatory reporting. And what effectively that would do is make it an offence for people who work with children not to report evidence or concerns about child sexual abuse. Now, it's quite controversial. It is legally tricky. You could see professionals being prosecuted. But people who watch this inquiry very closely believe that it is a solution which is justified by the size of the problem that the inquiry has identified over the years.
Tom, once again, many thanks. Tom Simons, our Home Affairs correspondent. Evacuation flights from Afghanistan could resume very soon, according to the Foreign Secretary, Dominic Raab, who's held talks with leaders in Qatar. More British nationals and Afghan allies are waiting to leave Afghanistan, and the airport in Kabul could be set to reopen in the coming days. Qatar says it is working with the Taliban to ensure that the airport is up and running as soon as possible. Our chief international correspondent, Lise Doucette, has been speaking to one contractor who worked at the British Embassy in Kabul.
Oh, there's Christmas.
Yeah.
Christmas parties, diplomatic dinners, daily meals. Head chef Hamid was part of British Embassy life in Kabul for 13 years. This was the last meeting of kitchen staff with the British ambassador, Sir Laurie Bristow. He spent days at Kabul airport overseeing the massive airlift. Hamid and about 60 others were left behind because they weren't employed by the Foreign Office, but through a private contractor.
We worked so hard, even during the COVID lockdown, and we're left behind. I feel I have been betrayed. If they don't take us out of here, it's a big betrayal.
Now this family of five young children is hiding at home. Today, in the Gulf state of Qatar, the BBC asked the Foreign Secretary about the contractors. He admitted many need help.
We will not be recognising the Taliban anytime in the foreseeable future. But I think there is an important scope for engagement and dialogue and to test the intentions and indeed the assurances that have already been made by the Taliban. Safe passage out of Afghanistan for and I'm afraid to my friend from the BBC, I didn't mention it, but to those Afghan workers or contractors who are eligible and still want to come to the UK or indeed other countries.
There's a battle at home. Brave women take to the streets in the western city of Herat. Don't be scared, we are all together, is their rallying cry. Worried the Taliban will stop them from working or studying as they did before. Mariam Rajai has moved from one safe house to the next ever since the Taliban swept into Kabul. She'd been working on issues like gender and human rights. The Taliban told her, don't come to the office for now. Many fear they'll never be allowed to go back.
As a human, it's my right to get education. It's my right to have a good job. Unfortunately, this situation that coming in Afghanistan, all of my dreams destroyed.
Kabul looks much the same, but it's not.
A nation at war now seems to be a nation in waiting. So many Afghans wondering, worrying, what kind of new government will emerge with all of its rules and regulations? Many others still asking ever so anxiously, how can they escape?
For now, so many lives are on pause. Lise Doucette, BBC News, Kabul.
At least 20 people have died after Hurricane Ida brought severe flash flooding and tornadoes to northeastern parts of the United States. New York, New Jersey declared a state of emergency as people were trapped in flooded basements and vehicles were swept away. And President Biden tonight said this latest disaster proved that the climate crisis was happening right now. Let's join our correspondent Neda Tofik, who's in New Jersey, with the latest.
Well, this has been a day filled with disbelief and despair. It was not long ago that people watched in shock as Hurricane Ida devastated Louisiana, never anticipating that they would be next. And there really was no warning that the storm's remnants would be this destructive, this life-threatening. Throughout the day, the death toll has climbed. The youngest victim, just 2 years old.
Cascading waterfalls rush through the platforms down to the tracks of New York City's subway. The sudden deluge from Ida's move up north shut down the network and didn't stop there. A state of emergency was called as the city became paralyzed by record-breaking rain and flash flooding, turning wide boulevards quickly into waterways. Motorists and a few out working despite the obstacles waded through the water to get home. Officials warned residents to remain indoors, but in parts of New York, houses were no longer a place of safety. Today, some were urgently saved from the rising waters on their doorsteps.
I think we're homeless right now, but this all, you know, we're all going to come together and we're going to figure out a solution, and we'll go from there.
It was the same story in Philadelphia, where there was no telling where the Delaware River ended and suburbs began. Rescuers went door to door by boat, helping people escape who took shelter in the upper floors of their homes and on their roofs. Others weren't so lucky, and today officials are still discovering the true death toll. After a year of extreme climate events that have shocked the nation, a warning from the president.
The past few days of Hurricane Ida and the wildfires in the West and the unprecedented flash floods in New York and New Jersey is yet another reminder that these extreme storms and the climate crisis are here. We need to be much better prepared. We need to act.
This storm for many is a wake-up call that nowhere is safe from extreme weather. Powerful tornadoes, the like seen normally in the Midwest, obliterated multiple homes in New Jersey. With the devastating impact of these events coming into view, it does feel like this is one of the greatest challenges of this generation. Neda Taufik, BBC News, New Jersey.
Let's turn to the latest news then on the pandemic and the latest figures, which show there were just over 38,000 new infections recorded in the latest 24-hour period, which means an average of 33,736 per day in the past week. The latest figures show that there were 7,500 people in hospital being treated for coronavirus yesterday. 178 deaths were reported in the latest 24-hour period. That's people who died within 28 days of a positive COVID test. And that takes the average deaths per day over the past week to 111. On the vaccinations, well, 88.6% of people aged 16 and over have now had their first jab. And just over 79% of the population aged 16 and over have had both doses. Well, after 18 months of disruption to schools in England, the Education Secretary, Gavin Williamson, says he expects a greater sense of normality this term as people start to return to the classroom. Masks and bubbles may have gone, but secondary pupils are still being encouraged to take regular COVID tests, and schools are being asked to ensure that spaces are well ventilated. Our education editor, Branwyn Jeffries, has the story.
Circle five times on each side.
The first test is the hardest. For these year sevens, the first time in secondary school too. The parents told me it's worth it as a step back towards normality.
We're happy to comply with what we need to do because I think it's for the best for everyone.
I think because of the last year we've had has been so unsettling, just to be normal. Get back to it.
There's still, you know, certain things that aren't normal, like coming in today for her first ever day here. She's coming in and having to do a lateral flow test. You know, sooner that we move away from that stuff, the better. I appreciate that they've got to do it at the moment.
I'm hoping that nothing like Corona doesn't spread anymore, like how it did last year, how it just happened so quickly and largely.
School staff have been vaccinated. Precautions today were to get accurate results. After this, teenagers will be asked to test at home.
Testing is now the main precaution in England's schools.
Masks have gone for pupils, and so have big year group bubbles. But both of those could be back on a local basis if cases rise. It's now much more up to schools to decide what precautions to put in place.
There's a lot less signage up. No one-way signs anymore.
For head teachers, more leeway to make decisions.
What we do know now is what's worked over the last 2 years, especially with last year as well. So we could draw on maybe putting bubbles together again. We could introduce face masks in different areas, making sure seating plans are set up in the right way. There's lots and lots of different things that we can draw on from what we know has worked in the last year.
For Year 11s, it's a crucial GCSE year. So what are their hopes?
Yeah, so I think exams at the end of the year, hopefully not another lockdown, of course.
I'm quite relieved because I felt quite trapped in the mask and it was quite annoying just going around school in the mask all the time.
I hope that it will really help people's mental health because I know lots of people who's in like my friendship groups, they've really had a hit on their mental health.
Pupils went back to school in Scotland 2 weeks ago. They've kept masks for the start of term, but even so, cases have risen rapidly. A reminder, the same may happen as schools open in the rest of the UK. Brownman Jeffries, BBC News, Colchester.
Dame Sarah Storey has become Great Britain's most successful Paralympic athlete of all time, after successfully defending the women's C45 road race title that she's held since London 2012. Dame Sarah's remarkable ride in Tokyo brought her the 17th gold medal of her career across two disciplines. Our sports correspondent Andy Swiss was watching in Tokyo.
Hurtling into history, the moment Dame Sarah Storey went where no British Paralympian has gone before. Amid torrential rain, though, how she had to work for it, Storey stayed out of trouble before surging clear with teammate Crystal Lane Wright and sprinting to glory. The result, an unprecedented feat for British sport.
17th Paralympic gold medal for her!
It is the culmination of a remarkable career. Born without a functioning left hand, Storey started as a swimmer. She was just 14 when she won her first Paralympic gold, before she switched to cycling with now record-breaking results. Her 17th title, so special.
To be Britain's most successful Paralympian, how does that sound?
I like the sound of that. It's something that I never anticipated happening to me. If you'd asked me that when I was 14, I'd have been, oh, well, yeah, maybe to go on to eclipse the record. That's something that I could never have even imagined happening.
It's now nearly 30 years since Storey made her Paralympic debut, but those closest to her say her drive and determination are stronger than ever.
She's just amazing, like how she manages to, find new ways, being in different environment chambers at high altitude, just to push her body even more. And she's just able to do that. And I think there are very few people in the world that are able to do that.
Well, the very British weather here has seen a landmark moment for British sport. And with Dame Sarah Storey already targeting the next Games in 2024, who knows how many more titles she could win. It wasn't Britain's only cycling success. Victory for Ben Watson in the road race. There was also gold in the pool as Bethany Firth took the 100 metres backstroke. And in the athletics, there was javelin joy for Dan Pembroke. And just look what it meant. But the result of the day was in the 200 metres, a Paralympic proposal for Cape Verde's Coelen Andrea Pereira Semedo from her guide runner Manuel. And to everyone's delight, she said yes. Talk about a fairy tale finish. Andy Swiss, BBC News, Tokyo.
US aviation authorities have grounded Virgin Galactic flights as they investigate the course of Sir Richard Branson's recent journey to the edge of space. In July, Spaceship Two carrying the British billionaire landed safely after just over an hour, but it's emerged that the flight did deviate from its planned trajectory. a journalist who alleges she was sexually assaulted while working undercover for the BBC on an expose about the fashion industry, has given a statement to French police about the incident more than two decades later. Lisa Brinkworth says she was attacked by one of the world's biggest model agents, Gerald Marie, who has denied the allegations and says they are false and defamatory. Our correspondent, Chichi Azundu, has the story.
I want justice for the women who were very, very young at the time, who have spoken to me, have told me about how being a model was a dream, it was a dream come true, and then how that very quickly turned to horror.
20 years ago, Lisa Brinkworth went undercover to expose sexual exploitation in the fashion industry. Posing as a model, the former BBC journalist spent a year collecting evidence, much of it focused on this man, Gerald Marie, the former head of Elite, one of the biggest model agencies in the world.
5th of October, 1998.
But during the filming, Lisa says she herself was sexually assaulted by him. Immediately after, she recorded this account of what happened.
I tried to push him off and I told him no. And there was absolutely nothing I could do. He had me pinned to the chair.
Lisa's assault wasn't broadcast in the documentary, and Elite Models sued the BBC, alleging misrepresentation. A confidential settlement was reached, and the BBC agreed never to show the documentary again.
I feel a responsibility myself because I started doing that work, and I feel that the settlement with Elite sort of halted progress, really.
But 20 years later, and galvanised by the Me Too movement, Lisa decided to revisit this story. It meant coming here to Paris, where Gerald Marie was based, in order for her to lodge a formal complaint of sexual assault against him. A year ago, she was accompanied by three other women making similar accusations. Now that number stands at 14.
And he had me pinned down on the bed, just right on top of me, and he tried to rape me. The question is, why did it take so long for women to be heard, for women to feel comfortable to come forward and tell their story?
I sat on the couch thinking that the others might arrive. He did say then that we were meeting them for dinner. And then he sort of pounced on me. But the main thing is, you know, he doesn't exist in a vacuum. You know, people knew he was doing that.
Despite more than a dozen women coming forward, because the allegations date back more than 20 years, according to French law, they've all run out of time to bring criminal proceedings against Gerald Marie. But Lisa is the only one allowed to bring a formal complaint because her lawyer argued she was prevented from reporting her assault to the police at the time. And the BBC says, though, it's doing everything it can to help her pursue her complaint.
That's why my clients want to send a message to say if you have been victim of any fact, just, you know, come forward.
Gerald Marie refutes all the allegations, which he says are false and defamatory. But the former models say they feel this is fashion's Me Too moment, and that even if their evidence doesn't lead to a prosecution, they hope their experiences highlight that fashion isn't all glitz and glamour. Gigi Azundu, BBC News.
Let's turn to the football news. Northern Ireland have won the first match in their World Cup qualifying campaign, beating Lithuania 4-1 tonight. It was a must-win for Ian Barraclough's side, and they lived up to the pressure with an impressive victory. Daniel Ballard opened scoring with his first international goal, and Northern Ireland now plays Switzerland at home on Wednesday. But there was a hostile atmosphere for England's 4-0 win in Budapest tonight, with Gareth Southgate's team being subjected to racist chants and missiles being thrown from the crowd. Despite the home fans being banned from UEFA competitions for homophobic and racist abuse, they were allowed to attend this FIFA World Cup qualifier. Our sports correspondent Natalie Perks has the story.
The Euros may have been a wild ride for England, but World Cup qualifying had so far been plain sailing. Hungary, though, represented a tough proposition both on and off the pitch. With no England fans allowed to travel, the 60,000-strong crowd was hostile. And after homophobia and racism from Hungarians during the Euros, pleas not to boo England fell on deaf ears.
Anyone caught booing would be banned.
Well, the legendary pop group ABBA have announced their first studio album for 40 years. ABBA Voyage will be released in November. It comprises 10 tracks, two of which were premiered during a global news conference earlier today. The quartet split up back in 1982, but they're now preparing for a tour with a difference, as our arts correspondent David Silito tells us.
I still have faith in you. I see it now.
ABBA and a new song. Indeed, a new album. 40 years on, Benny and Björn were in London to share some news. One of pop's greatest acts was back.
You're for freedom, I got to say, oh yeah, let's do that. You know, that was, I mean, they haven't been that interested in doing a new ABBA record, can tell you that, for like 35 years. But now they said, oh, okay.
I believe it is in there.
I remember when we stood the first day in front of the mixing console, yeah. The four of us, looking at each other, and everything came rushing back in seconds. That was so amazing.
It's 47 years since Waterloo, and ever since ABBA split up, they've been asked if they'd ever perform on stage again. And today they said, yes, sort of.
And the reason the announcement is taking place here in the Olympic Park is because this is where the ABBA concert